Okay, we have covered a lot of ground in this unit, and you may be feeling a bit overwhelmed, but there are a lot of concepts, but there's just a few key ones that we're going to encounter over and over as we go through this course, and you'll have a chance to review and deepen your understanding as the course proceeds. What I want to do now is just summarize very quickly some of the key concepts that you should take from this unit. So the goal has been to talk about semiconductors, what makes them different from metals and different from insulators, and how we dope them, which is what makes them so useful. And we've provided a lot of background to work up to that objective. So we are dealing with silicon as our sort of prototypical semiconductor, the most common semiconductor in use for semiconductor devices. And we've discussed a little bit about the silicon lattice. It looks a little bit complicated, but the key points to remember is that each silicon atom has four nearest neighbors. Silicon comes from column four of the periodic table, which means it has four valence electrons, and those two items go together. Silicon crystallizes in the diamond lattice, not the silicon lattice. We call it the diamond lattice. We specify various directions and planes in the silicon lattice with Miller indices. So that, for example, this particular plane on the top, that is a 1-0-0 plane. In a solid, the energy levels of the discrete silicon atoms broaden and smear out and become energy bands. And the important bands are the valence and conduction bands. So these two valence energy levels become valence bands and conduction bands in the semiconductor. At T equals zero, the valence band is completely filled with electrons that are participating in the covalent bonds. The empty states that arose from these unfilled P levels occur in the conduction band. And there's a forbidden gap. There are no states for electrons to occupy in that gap between the valence band and the conduction band. Now, at 300 Kelvin, there is a little bit of thermal energy, enough that there is a small probability that some minute fraction of these covalent bonds can be broken. Those broken bonds lead to holes in the valence band, just a few near the top of the valence band, and the electrons become electrons in the conduction band, just a few near the bottom of the conduction band. We call these intrinsic carriers. They're intrinsic to the pure silicon lattice, and they were produced by the thermal energy that broke those bonds. And we label them with the symbol N sub I. That's an important number for any semiconductor. We draw the energy band diagrams in this highly simplified way. We simply draw energy versus position. We indicate the top of the valence band only because that's where most of the holes will end up being. We indicate the bottom of the conduction band only because that's where most of the electrons will be. And the distance between the top of the valence band and the bottom of the conduction band is the band gap E sub G. We also talked briefly about the energy versus momentum characteristics of electrons in semiconductor crystals. The energy of an electron in the conduction band is its minimum energy, the potential energy it has at the bottom of the conduction band, plus its kinetic energy, momentum squared over 2 times the effective mass, not the actual rest mass of an electron in the vacuum, but the effective mass that accounts for all of the interactions with the crystal potential. And that gives us this parabola, which we call the EK characteristic. K because momentum is described by H bar times K, where K is 2 pi over the wavelength of the electrons that are participating in the semiconductor lattice. The valence band is a parabola turned upside down. So again, it's the maximum energy, the top of the valence band, and then the energy increases as we go down. The curvature is described by the effective mass of the holes. So effective mass is basically the curvature of these two parameters. This is what we call the band structure. It's a plot of energy versus crystal momentum for any semiconductor. And we are drawing here the simplest possible band structure, but it's one that is widely applicable and often used. So we'll be talking about two types of plots. One is this band structure plot that we just mentioned. It's energy versus crystal momentum. The other is the energy band diagram, which we also talked about, which is energy versus position. And we'll be using both of these. We then talked about the two most important characteristics of any semiconductor, the band gap and intrinsic carrier density, which go together. The larger the band gap, the more difficult it is to break covalent bonds, and the smaller the number of intrinsic carriers there are. For silicon, the band gap is about 1.1 eV, but there exists a whole range of other semiconductors that have larger and smaller band gaps than silicon. The intrinsic carrier density for silicon is 1 times 10 to the 10th per cubic centimeter at room temperature. That's a number that's worth remembering because we'll use it over and over again. For the larger band gap gallium arsenide, the number is considerably smaller. And for the smaller band gap germanium, the number is considerably higher. And we will see in a later lecture how we actually calculate intrinsic carrier densities based on the band gap and the other properties of the semiconducting crystal. Now, we also mentioned a little bit about how it is possible to produce electrons or holes that have a lot of kinetic energy that are far from the edges of the band. One way to do that is to shine light on a semiconductor with sufficient energy that can excite a hole from the valence band, put it into an electron in the conduction band far above the bottom of the conduction band, and the hole is below the top of the valence band. But we also talked about how that kinetic energy is rapidly dissipated through various processes that release either phonons or heat or thermal vibrations, and the electron quickly thermalizes and approaches the bottom of the conduction band. The hole approaches the top of the valence band. We also talked about how recombination can occur. An electron in the conduction band can drop down and fill up a hole in the valence band. The energy can be given off in a form of light. We use this property to produce light-emitting devices like light-emitting diodes and semiconductor lasers. This particular process happens in what we call a direct gap semiconductor, where the minimum of the conduction band energy is at the same momentum as the maximum of the valence band energy. So some semiconductors have that property. In particular, a semiconductor like gallium arsenide has that property, but silicon does not have that property, so it is not a good light emitter. Now, we also introduced this bonding model, which gives us a convenient way also to represent what's going on. We talked about how the breaking of these covalent bonds will lead to an electron that can wander around the crystal. That's an electron in the conduction band, but it also, that vacant bond can also wander around as other electrons from valence bonds hop into it. The hole can wander around the semiconductor crystal, and the hole can behave as though it's a positive charge-carrying particle. So we have electrons in the conduction band. When I talk about electrons in this course, I'll be referring to the electrons in the conduction band. We have holes in the valence band, and they can move about the crystal as well. And also, we talked about how the fact that electrons and holes can recombine, annihilate each other, give off the energy in terms of light or in terms of heat. Okay. We then moved on to describe doping. The most important property of semiconductors is that their electronic properties can be reproducibly and controllably changed by introducing small amounts of other elements into the silicon lattice. We refer to that process as doping. To dope the semiconductor n-type, to put more electrons in the conduction band, we'll use in silicon an element like phosphorus or arsenic. And we will substitute for one of the silicon atoms a phosphorus or arsenic atom. Phosphorus or arsenic are from column 5. They have one more valence electron. That valence electron is weakly bound to the phosphorus or arsenic atom. When that bond is broken by thermal energy at room temperature, that electron has been donated to the conduction band and can flow around in the crystal. The phosphorus atom has then acquired a positive charge because it's lost one electron. Something similar happens for p-type doping with gallium or boron. P-type dopants in silicon come from column 3 of the periodic table. There is one too few valence electrons to form bonds. That missing valence electron creates a hole. That hole can move around the semiconducting crystal, and we say we've doped a semiconductor p-type. Okay. All right, now we can also view this doping process in terms of an energy band. The way we would draw n-type doping is like this. The dashed lines up here represent the discrete levels that are introduced with each phosphorus atom that we put into the lattice. The energy of electrons in those levels is just a little bit below the conduction band. So with a little bit of thermal energy, we can break that bond and move an electron that is initially located on one of the dopants, break that bond with thermal energy, and put the electron in the conduction band where it can conduct electrical currents. Doing that creates an ionized donor because now we have one fewer electron with the phosphorus atom. Same kind of energy band diagram can be drawn to illustrate p-type dopants. The energy levels for the p-type dopants are just a little above the valence band. It then there's a missing electron. There's one too few there to satisfy the bonding requirements of its four nearest neighbors. But if we move an electron from the valence band, put it on the acceptor site, the acceptor acquires a negative charge because we put one more electron there, and we've left behind a hole in the valence band, and we've created p-type doping in the semiconductor. So that energy band picture can be useful to understand the operation of and electrical characteristics of doping in semiconductors. It also helps us understand what's different between insulators, metals, and semiconductors. An insulator is basically a semiconductor with a very large band gap. Very hard to create intrinsic carriers. A metal has no band gap. The carriers are already in the band. They've filled the band up halfway. They're free to move up into the empty states if we apply voltages and give them energy. Semiconductors have moderate band gaps. We can break a few of the bonds at room temperature, create a few intrinsic carriers, and what makes them so special is that we can dope them and reproducibly alter the number of electrons and holes in the conduction and valence band. We also discussed how we understand the carrier concentration versus temperature characteristic of a semiconductor. If we plot the electron density versus temperature in an n-type semiconductor, if we cool the semiconductor way down, there are no free carriers at all. There is not enough thermal energy to break the bond between the phosphorus atom and the weakly bound fifth electron, and there certainly isn't enough thermal energy to break the covalent bonds and create intrinsic carriers. As we heat the semiconductor up, we move from this freeze-out region to what we call the extrinsic region. We can ionize all the dopants. They can give their extra electrons to the conduction band. And now the concentration of electrons in the conduction band is very nearly equal to the concentration of phosphorus or arsenic dopants. But if we continue to heat the semiconductor, we start to break covalent bonds. We start to create electron hole pairs by exciting electrons across the band gap. If we heat it up enough, that process of creating intrinsic carriers overwhelms the doping and the semiconductor becomes intrinsic. So just to summarize the key concepts that you should take away and try to understand from this course is that the idea that energy levels are quantized in individual discrete atoms, for example, an isolated atom of silicon. But the idea that when we put atoms together and bond them together into a crystal lattice, these energy levels overlap and smear out and broaden into bands. Two kinds of bands. A band that are moved lower in energy, we call the valence band, and a band that moves up in energy that's mostly empty, we call the conduction band. We talked about two different types of charge carriers. Electrons in the conduction band and holes in the valence band. We talked about how we can alter the concentration of electrons and holes by introducing n-type or p-type dopants into the semiconductor. And we also talked briefly about how we understand the difference between insulators, metals, and semiconductors. So those are the main concepts that you should try to be familiar with in this unit of the course. And this is a summary of some of the terms that we have discussed in this unit. So you might go through these terms and try to remind yourself of what we mean by each of these individual terms. It would be a good way to review. If you find yourself attending a conference or reading a paper, these are the kinds of terms that semiconductor people will discuss and talk about frequently. So with this background, we have the background needed on the basic material properties of semiconductor crystals, and we're ready to move on in the next unit. In the next unit, we will be talking about some brief important concepts from quantum mechanics. Quantum mechanics could be a separate course in and of itself, but what we need to realize is that each particle can also behave as a wave. That's what quantum mechanics tell us. And there are a few important concepts that we need to understand as we move on and discuss more deeply semiconductor physics. Those concepts are the subject of the next unit. Thank you.